to order the Board of Health meeting for September 18th, 2018. I just want to thank you all for coming this evening. I know there's a lot of concern about this issue. I'd also like to acknowledge the select board members that are here, Dan Esbring and Andy Friedman. I've also been asked to acknowledge the Barry Berman, who's not here at the time being. That is basically because of the open meeting law. There cannot be a quorum of the selectmen, although I'm sure that the other select board would also have the same concern. John Halsey and Vanessa Alvarado, I'm sure, have that same concern. So I thank you for being here also. We're here tonight, and we'd like to discuss, I think, pretty much the agenda item for the rodent activity. I'm assuming that's what we're all here for. Excuse me, yes?
Usually you open it so that anyone can talk.
Well, since this is the only issue we have tonight, I would sort of like to give our little synopsis of what I think is going on, and then you can maybe respond to us, and we'll respond to you afterwards.
I can't talk about rats.
Okay.
I can't talk about secondhand smoke.
Okay, well, that is...
Sure.
Yeah. Oh, okay, that is not on the agenda, but sure. Let me open this up to the public discussion.
Okay. Do you want me to go up there?
Sure. If you could, yes. Your name?
My name is Ann Gordon, and I live on Bancroft Avenue. And I was hoping that the Board of Health could write an ordinance about secondhand smoke drifting from backyards into people's homes. You know, it's really horrible. And, I mean, you can call the police and complain about dog barking, but when your house is filled with smoke from your neighbor, there's nothing you can do. And I think, you know, with marijuana legal now, I think the time's come maybe that we could put some kind of ordinance in place that would help us deal with this issue. I know it's not a big problem in Reading because there's not that many smokers in Reading, but where it's a problem, it's very unpleasant.
All right, well, thank you for that. I think in our last meeting, I did bring up as one of the topics a recent study on the harmful effects of secondhand smoke. So I absolutely agree. Thank you for that.
So can we put it on the agenda go to the bylaw? I mean, what's the next?
Well, we can put it on the agenda for a future meeting, absolutely. Obviously, we won't be able to. It's not on the agenda for tonight.
Right. I didn't know about the rats. I'm sorry.
We'll definitely get it on as an agenda item in a future meeting.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your concern.
Okay. Good luck tonight.
Was there any other public comment not related to the rodent issue? With town employees. As you probably know, being a three-member board, we cannot discuss items amongst ourselves because of the open meeting laws and a quorum. So we have not really spoken about this issue, the three of us, since the last meeting we had. But we have had conversations with the town, and we are very concerned about the issue, just so you know. I would also, just to start, like to review some of the public health risks regarding rats and the chances or the likelihood of it being a real problem as a disease state in town. As you may be aware, there are different ways of transmission of bacteria, viruses, and parasites from rats to humans. Luckily, in this part of country, that is not very likely. There's a number of direct transmission methods which are caused by like rat feces, urine, rodent bites, one of which is a rat bite fever, bacterial infection caused by a bite or a scratch from an infected rat or rodent. This is very rare in the United States. I'm looking for some numbers to see how rare it was. In many states, it's not even a reportable disease. So the numbers are kind of unavailable, but it is a very rare thing in this state. Leptospirosis is also a bacterial infection caused from swimming or drinking infected water. That also is very rare in the Northeast, and it is mostly limited to tropical climates. A viral infection, antivirus, is caused by contact with urine feces or dust feces. That has been reported in 36 states in the year of 2017, but only one was in Massachusetts. 96% of the cases that have been reported are west of the Mississippi River, so that also is fairly rare, very rare in the state. Salmonella can also be directly transmitted through fecal contamination or food. That's very hard to determine where the salmonella, as you may be aware, the salmonella is fairly common, whether it's from a rat bite or rat contamination. It would be hard to disseminate. So that may also be a fairly rare occurrence in the state. And as far as indirect transmission, which would be from another insect like a tick or a flea, there would be a plague, which is also a bacterial. The bacterial transmitted after feeding from an infected rat. The numbers on the United States on that were 7 cases per year. So that is rare. Mostly of those were actually in the Southwest, in the rural Southwest. That is not very common here. Colorado tick fever is a viral infection from a tick bite. That is pretty much limited to the tropics and southern Europe. Any cases in the United States seem to be from tourists, so that is also very rare. Leishmaniasis is a parasite caused by the bite of a sandfly. That's pretty much seen in the tropics also, southern Europe. And the infection of tularemia, which is a bacterial infection caused by a tick and deer fly. That also is limited pretty much to south central United States, and there has been 5 reported cases in Martha's Vineyard from around here. That was in 2016. So that also would be pretty much rare. Probably the most common problem from rats in this area would be from allergies. A lot of people may be allergic to the dander of a rat. They do shed fairly often. Most of the problems that one might see from rats in the area would probably be from allergies.
That one case of hantavirus actually wasn't from Massachusetts. They were in Massachusetts when they were diagnosed, but it wasn't actually from Massachusetts. So there really is like not around there.
Okay.
But the one thing that I would add from the indirect transmission is that they're the only one other that I would add is Lyme disease, but it's sort of an issue with a lot of animals, small sort of rodent animals, but the rats do seem to be a good reservoir. Maybe as good as mice. Mice is sort of the number one reservoir, so there would be an associated increased risk for that, but hopefully people are already taking precautions because we know that we're in an area that does have Lyme disease, so, cover up, use repellent or whatever. You should be already doing that, so.
Now, would that be from the deer tick on rats?
Yeah.
Just in closing on that, there was one article published by the CDC that found that lethal kill trapping urban rat control may be associated with significant increase in the odds that surviving rats may carry increased levels of the leptospiral disease. does seem to increase for that particular disease. Although the risks resulting may be offset by the reduced number of rats, similar literature do suggest that such methods of killing them may be ineffective, and resources focused on reducing resources available to the rats, such as food, should be more readily used. Just one other thing. There was a question that came up regarding the whether dog feces does cause the attraction to rats. What I could find from the EPA, the CDC, the World Health Organization, there was no actual studies that I could find on it. I did find some contradictory information from wildlife and wildlife conservatory group and a company that a yard waste cleanup company. The yard waste cleanup company basically states that yes, it's a fine source of food for rats, whereas the wildlife control people disputed that. They did dispute that, so there's really no proof whether that does. What I would just recommend is for people to be very vigilant in cleaning up after one's animals. That would be a big help to the town, and hopefully that would not even be an issue. Is there any other comments from the board?
One other thing I wanted to add is this is sort of become a regional problem. I don't know how many of you have been researching in the news. There have been a lot of media reports from other communities who are having these problems. Good news is some of them have been trying measures so we can kind of see if they're working, what things might be working for them. We can model some of our ideas off of what they've done. But it does seem to be a bigger problem, generally speaking. There are national upticks. There's also, I think Boston was ranked the second rattiest city in the U.S., which anyone who's lived in Boston probably knows, yeah. But in 2016, there were upticks in Waltham, Melrose, Wakefield, Quincy, most of whom began more aggressive programs last year. And just this summer, there have been reports out of Beverly, Peabody, Danvers, Chelmsford, Woburn. So that's something that you need to recognize. This might be sort of a longer term issue, although people try and manage it.
I guess the next thing that we could speak about, and what you're probably waiting to hear, is what can the Board of Health do? What can we do to help alleviate this problem? That's something that we can talk about here this evening, to bring up some ideas. My personal idea is the first thing we can do is to strictly enforce the state sanitary code. Board of Health can do that. We would also request the public's help in doing that. Just off some of the public health codes, the sanitary codes, CMR 410550, this is where the public can help the town. The occupant of a dwelling containing one dwelling unit or owner of a dwelling containing two or more units shall maintain its premises free from all rodents, skunks, cockroaches, and insect infestation, and shall be responsible for exterminating them. Extermination shall be accomplished by eliminating harborage places of insects and rodents, by removing or making inaccessible materials that may serve as their food or breeding ground, and using any legal pest elimination method. caterers must give at least 48 hours notification to occupants of residential units prior to application of pesticides. I think that's one of the most important things that we can try to do is to remove sources of food and harbor for rodents. Everyone can do that. Every member of the public can do that. I would encourage everyone to try to do that. As far as what the Board of Health can actually do, there are a lot of codes that we can enforce pretty directly. CMR 410-600, garbage and mixed garbage and rubbish shall be stored in watertight receptacles with tight-fitting covers made of metal and other durable rodent-proof material. Garbage and rubbish shall be put out for collection no earlier than the day of collection. Is our day of collection is recommended by the code? Is ours the day before?
Day before.
Day before. So is it 4 o'clock the day before? So as long as you can keep yours contained, the better. We also, as far as our inspector's duty, and inspector, we do have a health agent. We do have 2 health inspectors currently. And as a board, we do delegate that responsibility to the health agent and inspectors, but the board is responsible for that also. We are not licensed inspectors, but we are responsible for things being inspected. When conditions specified in the following example exist, they will be deemed to be conditions which may endanger or impair public health and safety if determined by the inspector. Failure to comply with any provisions of the sanitary code, which results in the accumulation of garbage, rubbish, filth, or other causes of sickness, which may provide a food source or harborage for rodents, contribute to the spread of disease. So our inspector does have that ability to inspect properties for that. The Board of Health and its agent shall inspect the dwelling upon receipt of a written, oral, or telephone request for inspection. That is our responsibility to do. If we do get a report of a rodent, we have a responsibility to inspect for that. The inspection shall be scheduled at a time mutually satisfactory for the occupant and the health agent, and within 24 hours within receipt of the request, when the alleged condition represents a failure to maintain an area free from the rodents. The health agent shall keep a record of all requests, and which we are currently doing. Laura's doing a wonderful job keeping all of these reports down. The inspection will list the name, if given, of the person requesting the inspection, the time and date, the location, and the nature of alleged violation, and then the date inspected. At the time of the inspection, the inspector shall record violations, if any, and complete an inspection report. A verbal or written summary of the conditions noted during inspection shall be given to the occupant at its conclusion. If the inspection reveals that a dwelling does not comply with the preceding provisions, the health agent shall, within 12 hours after the inspection, order the owner or occupant to make good faith effort to correct the violation of failing to maintain the dwelling free of rodents, skunks, cockroaches, or infestation. This is my idea of what we should be doing, strictly enforcing. This is something that we as a board should, if there's any, this is basically the sanitary code. If we have any alterations of this, we can discuss that. But this is the code. This is the state code that we are required to follow up on. The reports, the notifications, and the service of the order will be determined, and the rights, there is a right to a hearing before the Board of Health if it's not taken care of. And there are penalties for violators. some of it, to a degree, I definitely agree with. But there's also a large part of the back of my head. It seems like this may be a little strict for people that are looking for some help and relief. Part of us would say, we're going to come on your dwelling and find you, rather than giving you help and relief. So I think there's some other things that, along with this, I'm not saying we don't look at this, but I think there's other things along with this that we should absolutely be trying to do in the essence of what can the town actually do. I think it was brought up by a resident who was having some issues at her own property that we've talked about what we can't do, and we should absolutely talk about things that we can do. And maybe getting a little bit more creative out of the box. I think there was a resident who was at the last meeting that was a private meeting held by the residents that are most affected by this at the library. And one of the residents, her name is Joanne, I'm forgetting her last name, let's see if she's here tonight. What was it? There she is. Joanne actually had a lot of great ideas in regards to if harborage is a big problem for these for a lot of this, and people have extra debris on their property or their bushes are so overgrown because they don't know what to do with it once they've cut it down, maybe we can arrange to have the town do extra pickups. As you know, we do leaf pickups twice a year. And by the way, the trees always fall after the last pickup, just so you maybe there's some additional things along those lines. I thought was a great idea to suggest, okay, let's see if we can help you out. We can't come on and fix your property, but if you're leaving this up the street, maybe with the leaf pickup, maybe we can arrange to have a company come back out and do some specialized pickups. So I think in conjunction with enforcing what we have in the books, I'd also like to make sure that we're giving some kind of relief and helping them not be in the scenarios where we're talking about getting fined unless it's an absolutely extreme case that we come to.
Yes, absolutely. Anything we can do to help. I know the town has been very good in offering ideas of what we may be able to do also. And that's probably what we should actually be speaking about tonight. In conjunction with the town, what can we actually do to help people, what can be done to help people? Some of the misinformation out there as applies to Reading. JRM said Reading's trash and recycling is among the cleanest of all his customers. So he's normally dealing with urban areas that throw all kinds of stuff away and recycle, including food. So if you're following the recycling rules and you're effectively, if you will, rinsing or washing everything you recycle that's plastic, no problem. There's no attraction to a rodent to come to look through your recycling. If your trash has a lid on it and it's covered and there's no holes in the barrel, there's also no attraction and no risk there. For someone that's a little less diligent with their recycling, which I occasionally do in the pizza box, you can get a sticker, and I believe it's at no cost, from the JRM or the town to use a trash barrel with a lid as recycling. Many of my neighbors do that. They have so much recycling. Instead of using the square bins with no lid, they use a trash barrel and they have a lid. So if you're throwing out recycling that's not as clean, maybe that's a suggestion. But I just want to make sure, in addition to the things we can do and the issues we should raise, that is not really an issue in Reading. It can be an issue in other areas, and you gave me some examples where people just aren't as diligent. So I wanted to pass that.
Dan Manson, the Select Board. Bob, just a follow-up question. Were you able to ask GRM percent of the Reading people actually use covered
so much they would have needed three square bins, so they just went to the one large receptacle.
I almost liken this to the concept of herd mentality. That's why we vaccinate our kids. We want lots of people doing the right thing, so
yeah.
Maybe some sort of a neighborhood core going door to door. I don't know how we do this, but just telling people about best practices. If five people on the block clean up their act and the other five don't, they got harborage in five places and not others, so you want this complete compliance issue. Okay.
And Kevin, you did, as part of our packet, we did have some information. Is that currently out being disseminated anywhere, like websites, or what have we done on that so far?
That's a good question. Does anyone know about on the websites?
Yeah,
okay.
On the town?
Not just the release, but the information on what the different towns have been doing. I don't think he put that on the website. So I don't think, because we haven't really discussed it, I don't think it's appropriate for us to put out there.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, what we did in the press release came from the CDC.
Okay.
So it was an informational-based source base only. This is stuff that other towns, other communities, specifically I know Wakefield being one of them, and stuff that they have done, and it's a pamphlet they put together. Another one from Cambridge, who put a whole packet together in regards to best practices, what can we refine the problem, prevention practices, eradication, and trapping, all these different aspects of it. So we have that tonight in our packet, but we haven't had a chance to discuss it as a whole. I think part of it, what we should be doing tonight is looking at the information coming out of this and coming up with something of our own. I know one of the other things that I've heard from residents, another resident came up to me at that private event at the library that was talking in regards to, I had this problem in Bath Witt. So I don't think this is certainly a new problem to Reading or to other communities. Maybe it's more in the light now because maybe it's around the other communities. Maybe it's a larger issue going on. But it seems to me that one of our policies should be a regular annual reminder, if you will, even something again that goes out with your water bill, total water bill, not tax bill. There's no reason tax bills anymore. What goes to put out with the water bill that, hey, here's best practices, or even having a night once a year where you can invite residents out to go over best practices. To me, this is something that I don't think you addressed today. Certainly we try to get ahead of it right now, but I think it's something that should be an ongoing concern for the Board of Health and make it an annual event, make it an annual thing, whatever we decide we want to do, just to make sure people understand this is where you can really help yourself out. This is how you can make your property less attractive. Hopefully, you talk to your neighbors about making their properties less attractive. These are this kind of spreading this word about best practices is really the most important part. You mentioned earlier, John, there's three things that the rats are looking for. They're looking for a food source, a water source, and harborage, a place to live. And that harborage is, you'd be surprised where they'll kind of set up shop. There's a lot of different places. Most of the rats that we have, or I should say really the only species of rat that we have around here, is a burrow. They like to burrow and live on the ground. So that's a big aspect of it. But if you starve them of the other two resources, their water and food, they're going to look for new harborage as well. So a lot of it is certainly preventive maintenance on your own properties, and that goes right down the list to best practices are sealing up cracks in foundations, walls, believe it or not, maybe something that the town can get involved with sidewalks as well too. If on the tree lawns we're seeing that there are burrow holes, and if that's something the town can get involved with to make sure that those sidewalks are sealed. These are all kind of part of what best practices have come out of some other communities who have gone down this road and kind of invented the wheel for us already, so to speak.
Yes, the Cambridge, the one that you sent out, Kevin, the one from the city of Cambridge was excellent.
Yeah.
Would we have permission to put that on our website? Is that something we could do?
I'm sure we probably have to talk to Cambridge first, right?
Mm-hmm.
If it's on their website, let's do it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You can steal anything we want.
I always hesitate to just do it unless we've had somebody vet it.
Mm-hmm.
But
I've pretty much looked at it. It was very extensive.
I thought it was it's a great package.
It's excellent.
They seem to have nailed it down.
Is there any objection to putting that on our website? I would think that, as far as an informational piece of literature, that I thought that was excellent.
So my question, I say as long as someone vets it. Now my next question is, who would actually do that?
I mean, I'm not an expert on that, but it looked very complete.
Do they cite sources on here?
Why don't we just call it Cambridge? That's the most common.
Okay.
See, it's DPW as well as Cambridge.
Okay.
Make sure people don't call the number or email.
Well, yeah, we'll have to change the background. Maybe they can even give us a maybe they can give us a PDF so we can modify it to our own needs. And information as far as numbers and contact, what have you. That would be good.
Mr. Chair?
Any other comments?
I have a general question.
Sure.
So, have you looked into the time frame for how long it takes to get rid of a rat infestation? I know from personal experience 7 years ago that it took me a year or two before it finally went away.
I think the problem with eradication is it's almost impossible to get rid of all the rats. Extermination, you're never going to exterminate every rat. I just don't think it's possible. That's why these measures are so important, to cut back on the sources. To be honest, I don't know if there is a day or a month. I don't think there is.
I mean, you can, I guess more of my question was, if your home is infested with rats, eventually you can get them to go away. Just somebody else's home, maybe. but that, in my experience, it took a long time. And I don't know if there's any information on that. So just to set expectations that people think, they started attacking the rats on day one, 6 months later, they're still having an issue. Is that to be expected, or is...
Well, I think a lot would depend on neighbors and neighboring areas.
Yeah.
I mean, if you've done everything, if you've done your due diligence to make sure that there's no food, no clippings, no garbage, if a neighbor a couple houses down hasn't done the same thing, it's kind of hard to say.
Okay.
I think that's why it's so important for it to be a community effort with everybody. Any other questions before we open it up to the public?
Thanks for asking that question. In regards to town and land, are we able to do anything?
I think so, right?
I was going to say we've discussed, but really I've discussed, people have listened, that we should take a serious look at shutting down Washington Park and having an exterminator. It says better? There we go. Washington Park. First of all, the reports of rodents and
stand up, give us your name and address.
Matt Stroh on Bush Street. You talked a lot about what we can do, and that's very helpful. I feel like there's a big piece here that you haven't talked about. There are multiple large construction projects going on, whether they're private or they're municipal projects, road work or whatever. Washington Park is a couple of blocks behind the train station. It's also a couple of blocks behind the enormous storage building that they took down. So I'm presuming that as a condition of getting a building permit, you need to treat for rodents. Is there an ongoing obligation? Does anybody go back and check? Does anybody look for neighbors? Like, what is done on an ongoing basis? Because you could probably find them around a lot of those.
Sure. No, there absolutely is a process. Before you can take a building down, you do have to prove that, obviously, there is no infestation.
Yeah.
Or eradicate one or the other. You have to satisfy the Board of Health, and specifically the health inspectors, as to that. From an ongoing standpoint, I don't believe after that point they're actually obligated to. However, I know in this case that one construction project has actually done that. They have rebated, they have re-put traps out there, to continue along as far as the rest of this construction project is going. So they've done that voluntarily.
Okay, but they've rebated on that site.
Correct.
But if the rodents have left the site, then that's not going to be good.
Then that's
so,
not going to
so
be good.
What does Is there an obligation if I live next door to that and have roads that, you know, is there any, can the town make it a condition that, you know, within 6 months then they have to reimburse for treatment or something like that? No. Well, it's private. Okay, the construction company would reimburse as part, as a condition of their building permit.
As yet, there's been no evidence on that site of any rats, which surprised me. Given the vacant building for so many years, I would have thought so. They've had a pretty thorough plan and they've caught nothing. They've seen no evidence. That's what I've heard. And not from them, I've heard from moving people. Which does surprise me. And you know, Boy Street isn't far away. And yet the immediate neighbors I've not heard from. So who knows?
And I haven't seen it because I'm not on Facebook, but there is a private Facebook page for that neighborhood. There's been plenty of activity in that neighborhood. It's unfortunate that they haven't let you know. But
if that's true, then that certainly is.
I don't because I'm
okay.
But okay, I mean, I guess that was it. But that seems to be like I can cover my recycling. That's great. But if even the town, if you're ripping a street up and or that you know you're flushing pipes and there's rats coming out of the sewer, you said they were borrowers. I can't pave my lawn. They're gonna borrow into my lawn whether I put my recycling if it's covered or not.
I was just asking the question. Single home demolition have the same obligation. The answer is yes.
I don't doubt that it's on paper. I'm just you talked about strict enforcement, so I'm asking about follow-ups and that's all.
And then the town, for what it's worth, for all its buildings, has a very, we're in a school, as you'd imagine, a very sophisticated integrated waste management control system that is regularly checked and updated and changed.
Okay.
And I think to Matt, what you're speaking to is, can you enforce it moving forward?
Yeah.
I think that was the kind of the real question.
I mean, there's a giant house on West Street, or Summer Ave, that they're going to put a school up in, and there was a lot of debate about that. But if they start tearing barns down, that house has been vacant for probably a year. It's a big old house. They're going to do something on the ground, is what I'm told. So what's going to be done to keep, you know, now Summer Ave and Boy Street again and all that area from suffering this again?
It's a good question. I don't know if anybody up here actually has the answer tonight. It sounds
sure.
Like it's part legal and part building codes question. I don't know, does anybody know the definitive answer to what he's looking for? In other words, is there anything we can do to enforce from the permit still being open to making sure that the residents, direct butters maybe, are taken care of in some fashion by the building to be made whole from not having issue on the property. My thought is, it sounds like it's a legal question. Probably the state codes involved. I don't know anyone up there. I don't know the answer to it. I don't know anyone else does. I can certainly find out.
Yeah, most builders they want to be good neighbors for a short period of time.
Sure.
So you just talk.
Hi, I'm Jean Delios. I just wanted to weigh in the town of Reading. I've been here for 9 years. town of Reading takes the permitting process very seriously. We're actually criticized for being overly demanding on what we require when projects come through to get permitted. And I've been in planning and community development, I would say, my whole career. This is all I've done. I've worked for multiple cities and towns in the area, and I've never seen a town that is as diligent as the town of Reading. And because of that diligence, I just want everyone to be aware that the team in my department of public services works together. Building, health, planning, we all sit together in the same office. And so we all share information and we all collaborate on how to solve problems. And so it's not uncommon, in fact it happens all the time, that the health agent taps a shoulder with the building inspector when there's possibly an issue somewhere, and vice versa. So there's a lot of teamwork that goes into staying on top of things related to construction and related to permitting. We really, I think, can begin to think about solutions and steps going forward, and I think office to be commended for taking the lead on that. And as I've told the board members individually, the staff is here to assist in any way that we can. And I just want to make that very, very clear.
John, Mr. Chair.
Yes.
In response to your question about rats being displaced from buildings that are demolished,
just speak up, please.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Yeah. In response to his question about are rats being displaced from buildings that are being demolished or heavily renovated, the big question is, are there rats there to begin with? And rats, as some of you may know, leave quite a few signs around that they're there. So maybe we could consider before buildings are demolished or major renovation is going on, where the ground will be disturbed, is to have someone inspect the building and see if there's any rat activity.
That's what we do.
So it's not just rat buildings, it's also looking for rodent activity.
Correct, yes.
Which pest control company is that?
Eastern.
Yeah, we're not, most of the neighborhood's not using Eastern. I don't think that's not right. No. So that wouldn't be the one. Another question that I thought of, and I'm sorry, I don't mean to monopolize the time. So you inspect a building before it's going to be taken down, and if there's evidence, then they have to remediate it. So there must have been evidence of rats at the storage place if they took steps. Right?
They have to have a plan. They have to have a rodent control plan.
Okay.
Which.
Okay. Right.
So no matter what, you have to have a pest control company, and they have to have a plan in place before they can do any demolition. And that plan has to stay during the entire time of demolition construction.
So that's automatic.
The Board of Health and the Health Department has to sign off before a demolition. That is one of the conditions in order for us to sign off the demolition.
On the plan?
For a rodent control plan, correct.
So there doesn't have to be signs, in other words. They have to put the plan in place regardless. That doesn't necessarily mean there were signs, right?
Okay.
And that was one of the things that we did, Laura and I, before before the Prescott teardowns is we did a physical inspection of all of the potential sources of food around the whole area. There weren't any signs of rodents in that area to begin with, and if there were the dispersion of them, they would look for food and other harvest. The inspections that we did before the demolition showed no signs of any dumpsters that looked in need of repair. We did a fairly thorough investigation of that area.
And I don't doubt that. I would suggest maybe trying to talk to some of the neighbors there because I think that they get an issue in the immediate year.
Did you say South Washington Park?
Next question, yes, you're next. Name and address, please.
Kevin Signetti, 13 Smith Avenue. I've been a resident there for 45 years. I noticed when I walked in, Jean gave me a look. She said, oh my God, he's back again. but in any event, I've been in several of the planning board meetings. I've paid a fair amount of attention to what's going on in terms of development. And I do have a question and probably not an answer at this particular point. But is the preponderance of rats increasing as a result of the numbers of construction sites that we're putting here and putting in the ground? Also, that's one question, but I have more to go. I've been a resident of 13 Smith Avenue for 45 years, but I remember when the dump was capped and the rats were every place, and the town of Reading did almost nothing. Now, what they did, and this was a problem for probably 2 or 3 years after they started to construct the buildings on Marketville Drive. And the rats were dispersed into our neighborhoods, no different than that which is happening on this side of the town. My real question is, and rather aggressive proportionally, we're just talking about taking down a building. My real question is, when you don't take down a building, and you establish new buildings. As an example, the Lakeview Eaton project, which is a 40B project, which in my opinion, again, in my case, in my opinion, but nonetheless, it appears as if it's going to go through. Is there a provision for, number one, the developer to control the rat population of the area before they start, during the time that they develop, and after they develop? That's a question. Finally, it appears that what you guys are talking about is the onus responsibility for rat control is on the townspeople. My question would be, other than looking to hire some sort of a pest control company, what else is the town doing to not eliminate, I know it's impossible to eliminate rats, but to reduce the number of rats, other than having people put caps on it, on their trash, making sure that they don't have piles of wood in the front yard, what is the town doing? Thank you.
Answering your first question, as Emmy had mentioned earlier, that the increase in rat population is not specific to Reading right now. I think this whole area we're seeing increases in the population throughout this whole area of the state. So I guess the second part of your question is what can we do? We're trying to understand the scope of the problem and trying to give information of how we all as a community can deal with it. It's not our purview to eradicate the population of rats. As you said, that is probably impossible. But through education that we can do, we can work with the town. As Bob had mentioned, we're thinking of possibly closing off the park, where it seems to be a large part of the problem. That is a possibility. That's sort of why we're here today, to try to figure out ways that we all as a community can stop this influx of rodents.
A couple things. I think you make a good point about.
Can you speak up a little bit? bit.
Sorry.
One of the first things for me to go is my hair.
I think you make a good point about the building permits. I think you talked about that at the last meeting, that we only have the rat control plans for demolition. Is that correct? So is that something we could explore for any building permit type project or expanding that?
Is that part of the building permit process?
The reason that it's tied to the demolition permit is because that's the regulation that gives the health agent the authority to require that information and to do that monitoring. So you would have to have a regulation that would tie earth moving, construction, any number of other things. And there are other communities out there, and I've done some of the research, cities in particular, where they're coming up with local bylaws specifically aimed at this issue. I have a model bylaw from the city of Peabody where I used to work. My former colleague was nice enough to let me take a look at it. It hasn't even gone before the city council yet. But we do have that as one idea for having more laws in the town of Reading around this issue, and more regulation, and more requirements associated with building permits and all that. Earth moving is another area. If you're excavating a site and you're doing something with regrading and you're moving so much fill, that would be another opportunity to add regulation and requirements to that process.
So I guess we could bring that up, put that on the agenda for a future meeting, and review some of the other cities and towns' regulations for that. That would be a very good idea to do.
Yes, sir.
Everett Bond, 99 Prescott Street. I'm trying to be positive about this because it's really people that cause the problem. It's the environment, and the more people you have, the more rights you're going to have. I'm thinking about the Lincoln's Prescott Street project. First of all, I would encourage them to look at the order on how things are done. When you go down there and dig for water drainage, and then you go down there and dig the site to see what's under the foundation, and then you go down there and dig to clean up the mess that's in the back alley, and then you test the site for the rats. They're probably already gone. The trouble isn't as many there because there's not a great food supply down there either. So I think that's part of the problem. So I can pro and con that one, and that's the problem. You can do all the pros you want, but the cons, you've got to go down. You got to eliminate the food supply, you got to eliminate the environment. Thinking about that, I'm thinking of the parks where our kids are, my kids work. I would think that after the games, when the stuff is under the bleachers and the barrels, and the barrels down at the depot and things like that, rats are active at night. They clean up our messes. I think there's going to be some sort of that's a potentially very good source.
Yeah, would it be possible to, I don't know how much these costs are, I don't know if this is even an option, but in places like that have rat-proof, you know, covered trash receptacles?
You have the trash compactors.
Or the smoking facility.
Yeah, I think
the
solar power.
Our public works department and our facilities department are quite aware of the issue well before it became popular recently. They look for evidence of rats all the time, especially near schools, because a lot of the athletic fields are near schools. There are reports. There are occasional reports. I got one a couple weeks ago near the high school. There's one rat. So that's constant vigilance. One of the issues, one of the challenges is the frequency at which some of the trash is picked up. always know what groups are using the fields because not all of them register. And even more challenging is we don't know which groups are going to create the most trash and be the most sloppy about it. Generally speaking, DPW and facilities do not work on Saturday and Sunday, and that's when it happens. And Monday when they're cleaning up and they realize the mess, you know, that's something we've talked about, Sunday cleanups. But in general, so far, this type of issue has not been a big cause. And that's, from my perspective, what I want to know is, what is the cause? We can't fix it until we know the cause. We understand the issue, we absolutely acknowledge it, but we've spent the last 3 weeks as detectives trying to figure out why. We understand what they're attracted to, but is there a single cause, or are there multiple causes? Why is this all of a sudden become more of an issue? I talked to other town managers, it's absolutely an issue there. I actually called the head of the MWRA and I said, is the construction you're doing in Stoneham sending the rats up to Reading? And if so, please send them back. And he said, where are the rats? And I told him where. He said, that's too far, they never travel. One of the residents suggested they were coming out of the water pipes, and I said, would you rather them stay in the water pipes? He said, no, I suppose I'd rather them come out. But our trash firm, as well as the MWRA, have a much broader perspective than any of us do on this issue. Specifically, the MWRA said North Boston is the worst place, period, not even close. And he named all the communities. He didn't name Reading because he hadn't heard about our issue yet, but he named all of our neighbors. And he said there's been some talk that some of the work in Boston, you see all the cranes going there, that they're displacing rats, and they seem to be heading north. There's no proof of that. So what we've tried to figure out is, in Reading, what are the reasons there are rats here? And if it's the same reason as they're in Woburn and Wakefield, Stone, we can take the same approach that they do. But if there's something different, we need to know that. We all understand that, you know, together in some way we need to solve the problem, but we really need to identify the reason first and try to remove it or change it.
Yes,
I'm Frank Coleman. I live at 26 Randall Road, as I think previously. John and Bob and I discussed that issue briefly, but you didn't have an issue.
I didn't hear Ben.
Okay, so I have just a comment to make and a quick question. At the last meeting, there was some debate between a couple of gentlemen about using firearms to eradicate rats. It was brought up, the point was brought up that it's illegal and ready to discharge a firearm within so many feet of a residence. Don't get me wrong, I don't need to. But I just thought I'd clarify this. Although, actually, with some of the remedies I've seen at Lowe's, the gun would be much more humane than some of the stuff they're selling. It would be waterboarding than that. The law is, as I understand it, the bylaw is if you have a firearm and you're in defense of your family, your property, or yourself, you can discharge that fire.
Correct.
Or if you're on a neighbor's property and he gives you written permission. I don't think we're going to call policies in which I just wanted to clarify that. My question is, I kind of thought this was really a West Side problem. That's where the big emphasis is. Are you folks telling us this is all over town, or is this still really primarily a West Side problem?
Say primarily southwest corner, but not exclusive. There's been some reports in and around the library, right? In the neighborhood. Maybe one or two. I forget. But yes, the vast majority is in the southwest corner of the town, south of 129, west of Main Street.
Southwest would be roughly intersection of 93 and 128.
Roughly.
Could you be more specific? Particular neighborhoods have had multiple reports of David Lowry, Franklin Street.
There's some information on the town's website. I don't know if we have a map. I know someone else has a map on Facebook.
But you do have posted information about.
Yeah, it's
reported sightings.
Now, I live in County Road. It's been the County Road area. There's been half a dozen or a dozen sightings there. Boy Street was early. We haven't heard any recently, or at least I haven't. And then I can't remember. There's one street in between that.
Carlisle
your concern, I don't think there's been many up around the Franklin Street area.
No, no, I mean, it was it's news out of the thing.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, can I just say one quick thing, and that is that I saw a media report, I think from maybe May, where in Woburn, the city councilors for two specific wards were noticing upticks. Those two wards were the easternmost ward and the northernmost ward. So the easternmost ward is just to the other side of 93 from the county road area. So it's most likely not just on that side, it's, you know, probably both towns.
Yes. Yep, behind you, yes.
I just want to emphasize, Dave Thomas on Boyd Street, that part of your going to put out information is
you know, that was one thing that was kind of a surprise to me was that, but yet it makes sense that you need to hear those reports to know where they are and where they're coming from. I'm feeling pretty confident that it's more than just a few streets that have gotten loud. You know, so I just hope that there's at the minimum, I like some of the other discussions that have come up. We really hope that you guys can have some power to enact change going forward at a greater and possible legal level, but at the very minimal, you're getting information out to residents, you're encouraging them to report it, and not just once, to give updates, and you're also talking about people's habits, like you had mentioned earlier. That also includes, you know, gardens. People really are into their gardens, and I think that might get it to be like a sensitive area, because I understand, you know, gardening is therapeutic in a lot of ways, but you might want to mention that too. And I think that might be something that people are going to have to think about for a while before they're willing to give something like that up. But if we're eliminating food sources, I know that's a really kind of new popular trend is to, you know, food.
So actually what I have read is that as long as gardens are clean, they tend not to be, it seems counterintuitive, but they tend not to be big problems. Even compost piles tend not to really attract rats, which does sound strange.
I wish Andy was still right here because he had actually talked about his own garden in the past.
And he had problems with it.
To me, a food source is a food source. But I'm not an expert, so I would defer to you. But
well, I think that's why it is important to report to us where the activity may be, because we could then inspect find out if there is something going on that may be causing that. So that's why I think the report is so important. Yes.
Hi, thank you. Joanne Hans for County Road. As my neighbors know, I'm having my porch rebuilt and I have a permit for it and everything. Construction and demolition waste. There's a dumpster that was, you know, this is all permitted for the construction waste. This is my, so can the town help us? Like, I feel stymied in trying to do my part to help, you know, with this rat situation where I can't even put my trash out. So it wasn't picked up.
Is your trash still out?
It's in my backyard under a tarp.
Okay, I can look into it. JRM can always make a visit if they know in advance. Please do this thing, they will.
Can we get stickers if we're doing something like this that they look like, if I put it out next Monday, will it go?
With a sticker, it absolutely would. There's a fine line between
what they think construction material is and isn't, and weight is definitely one of the indications they use. I've thrown away heavy things in a trash barrel in a bag and they've taken them. So if you have it on a trash barrel, within your limit, that might be another option. If it's really heavy, that's why.
Well, it's in a trap. Well, the heaviest one is in a trash barrel now, and I lifted it and put it in the trash barrel.
They wouldn't take that?
This was after when I was cleaning up what they didn't take.
Well, I'll circle back to you. I know where you live. JRM is a good partner. They're willing to work with us, but as a default, they won't pick that stuff up unless we tell them.
Right, and I might be off the heavy contract with that because we were told not to use flimsy stuff.
Yes, very patient.
Hi, Julie Silkvitz, I'm on Milton Road. So I've lived in Reading my entire life, and I've lived through the Tom Dog rats and the Imagination Station closing because of rats. And I guess I just kind of want an understanding of, I know we have like a lot of things that we can do, and some sites we've identified, and some ways we can stop this, right? So is there like a timeline on when we're gonna start? Because if we know that Washington Park's an issue, can we, like, let's do it? What are we waiting for? Because Imagination Station was a beautiful park, I played there, and that got destroyed by rats, and now it's gone. So I think people with kids in the town would rather have it shut down for a month, and they can't bring your dog to the park, because we're getting rid of rats there, because we know rats are there. I mean, I knew rats were in my backyard, and so I have rat boxes, and now I'm praying they're not there anymore. But I think we know what our issues are. For instance, like, we know there's rats at Dunkin' Donuts on West Street. There's holes everywhere. I get nice coffee there. It's been reported. And I drive by there every morning, and I've actually stopped getting iced coffee there because the same trash is at that Dunkin' Donuts that are in pictures you took weeks ago. And it's not getting policed. So where it is, it's definitely there. And so like, can we just like get a timeline on, here's the steps we're gonna take on the known issues so that we can, you know, maybe if we kill 10 rats, it's 100 rats less in like 3 weeks.
Well, that would be the timeline on the regulations that I speak. Do we get a report for the Dunkin' Donuts?
We actually sent an inspector out to the Dunkin' Donuts. There was no evidence of rat. I have taken my lunch and sat in the parking lot and watched the parking lot for over a half hour.
You go there at 2 a.m.
Yeah, exactly. I circled your neighborhood at 11 with my kid in the back seat. We haven't been out at 2 a.m., but is Dunkin' Donuts open at 2 a.m.?
No, but rats are
I've gotten reports that there's rats running around Dunkin' Donuts parking lot in the middle of the day. I've sat there for a half hour at a time staring, and I've seen nothing.
But you say there were holes in the foundation?
There's holes right where the drive-thru window is. There's giant holes. They're not chipmunk holes. They're definitely rat holes. As a rat victim myself, they're huge. And the fact is, I mean, there's still trash everywhere there. So if we're going to say trash is part of the issue, the same trash is still on the side near that fence that was there 3 weeks ago when we first brought this item up. So I just think, even for a boost of confidence from the town people, if little things that are being brought up as issues were fixed, maybe the confidence level would be heightened. Because right now, all I'm thinking of is I'm going to come downstairs to rat my kitchen come wintertime.
Yeah, if there is trash out there, that is unacceptable.
That
should be looked into, absolutely.
Yeah, we did send an inspector out, just so you know. And I saw it as well with a couple of rappers and empty cups, you know, people throw things out the window.
Responsible for the anti-litter, enforcing anti-litter bylaws.
sanitizing the dumpster, that is something that the Board of Health has the ability to require that.
Yep.
Is that something we should start looking into as far as sanitizing, having vendors sanitize their
dumpster?
Yep,
they've been advised to sanitize the dumpster and sanitize the dumpster.
They've been advised that they've been ordered. She was first though, I'm sorry. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Joan Potter, Riverside Drive. I was at the meeting last week with these lovely ladies that coordinated.
And there, people were showing picture after picture after picture, reporting, you know, multiple rats in the area. I mean, this crowd is very calm and understated compared to, I mean, people were angry last week. But in the course of the conversation, I swore I heard that you were gonna double up the inspections on some of these these areas that have, I guess, been overlooked for way too long. I was told by the woman, you with the scarf next to Jean, that that things were gonna be, inspections were gonna be ramped up to get the trash off the streets, to get the trash off of, you know, by the dumpsters. And what I'm hearing from you right now is that, you know, I know it wasn't an official inspection, but, you know, sitting, having whatever.
There was an inspection.
No, her unofficial inspection. I mean.
No, she sent the inspector out.
There was an inspector.
But
she would just went there out of her own curiosity.
No, I know that. But we were told at the meeting last week, right, that they were going to be doubled up. Inspections were going to be ramped up until we got a hold of this situation to get the trash off of the locations, to get the trash, you know, in control. Because if trash has been there for 3 weeks, you know, it doesn't take a brain surgeon to figure out that's kind of where a problem is beginning. And they're hanging around there because the eats are good.
You're right, but our inspections are increasing, correct?
This went up on the 23rd. Less than a month is up. So it's twice a year now. Where can we see the inspection reports? Are they posted somewhere?
It is a public record. It's not online.
You can just go to the city clerk's office and request a copy of it. Yeah.
Yes.
Clean new dumpster, yes. Although the trash that was sitting there near, there's a picnic table there, is still sitting there. I have pictures on my phone with dates, it's still there. You know, it's just, I don't know if there's a manager on the property or what, but
so
there's.
When you're referring to trash, I just want to clarify. Are you talking about in the dumpster, are you talking about outside?
No, on the ground, litter. Food, litter. There's a picnic table. Yeah, and that's where I've seen rats, you know, pulling in only at night. I've never seen a rat there during the day. I think it's rare to see a rat during the day.
Right.
This is why
after
the town doesn't realize
exactly
they have rats because they're not seeing them. So that's one area of concern because, like I said, I live right there, right near there. Another huge concern is Archstone or Reading Commons now. I've gone in there and looked in there, and they're literally inches, they're on my property line. Back left of my property, or my brother-in-law's property, I should say, next door to me. Their dumpster is, you know, it's overflowing, and I know it's being, I don't know how often that it's supposed to be dumped. I don't know, you know, I'm just curious on all these guidelines for places like this. The truck comes in and dumps it. What about all the things, and I've sent more pictures to you, the select board and the town manager, this evening. There's
what about all the trash that doesn't land in the dumpster that's all over the ground? You know, I sent pictures of those things. And, you know, what are the guidelines for those to, I mean, who's, what about the dumpsters that are underground?
That is the owner's responsibility to the environment.
So whose responsibility is it to make sure that they're doing that, because they're not?
Well, that would be a report to the health agent. And if it showed, when we did an inspection on it, and it was found to be deficient, then there would be a warning or a violation. And that's the report that we were speaking about earlier, that if there was a violation, it would be a report, and it would have to be remedied. But that is the owner of the property owner's responsibility to keep it clean. If the dumpster company does not do it sufficiently, it's up to the owner to get them to do that. It's basically the owner's responsibility.
How often is a place like that, just out of curiosity,
how often is a place like that, and I understand a few of the larger buildings in the back have underground parking, and there are a lot of dumpsters inside that parking garage. Are those, I wasn't aware of that because I don't see them, but residents there have told me that there's some rat issues in those dumpsters that are in their parking garages. How often is a place like that required to be inspected? Or is it a requirement? Is there a law? I mean,
this is one of those situations where it'd be often helpful if a resident of Archstone would talk to the town instead of neighbors. We've got no reports from Archstone. We have only 36 reports in the entire town. That's why I'm saying fact-based things is what we need.
Well, how can we make that?
Archstone has compactors. We're not aware that they have dumpsters in the traditional sense that, for instance, Mobile does. I can't tell you, it's been a long time since I drove around there, but when you just said there was sort of trash all around, did you mean at Archstone in some areas?
No, Archstone, for the most part, I think is kept clean. Okay. When I say trash all around, I'm talking about that, it's like a housing unit for recycling bins and then that compactor. But on the sides of it, I sent more pictures, you'll see, you know, on the edges, there's old, you know, just things that don't land in the dumpster. And I imagine the man that comes in the truck and his truck picks it up and scoops it isn't coming up and picking up those things, you know.
It's not a dumpster. And I have been around there, and that had that had a sofa, a dollhouse.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not food source. There's a huge no trespassing sign right before you enter the property, and that is private property.
Okay, well then I can go on my side and take over.
We actually called the management office, Laura and I, to try and get some information, and they were very, very nice. And we looked on the town's website about the property. We could see it on our aerial and on GIS. So we looked very closely at Archstone, and we've reached out to them. Laura's taken a ride through there, even though she's not supposed to.
No, they're not connected.
I mean, the point I think that we want to make is. Having a plan of all the things that we've talked about tonight and then executing that plan in a way that is legal so that if we do need to have access to properties, we're following the correct legal channels. Because as much as we want to be diligent about doing our jobs, we also want to be on the right side of the law. So I think that all of these ideas are great ideas. We're going to have to think about resources to do this. Laura cannot continue to spend the kind of time she spent on this. We're going to need outside resources, and I know the board's going to want to talk about that. And we have some ideas on how to get outside resources, because this is a very demanding set of circumstances.
How can we get this information out, like he was saying? People need to know that if they see a rat, where to report it. How can we get this, like Mr. Sexton was talking about, maybe on the water. How can the town notify the people living in the town? How could you notify all of us on what to do and ways to keep, you know, our yards less desirable for rats? How can we get that out besides the website? Is there a mailing? I know we've mentioned it, but how, when are we going to do that?
Can you robocall residents like they do for
school? Yeah, what are some options on getting the word out?
I know you don't want to create like a freak out either.
Right.
So, I'll think about it.
I'll let the town manager talk about that one. But going back to what I said earlier in the evening, to me this seems to be something we need to look at annually, not just when it's a problem. Right? When it's a problem, obviously we need to address, we want to address it, and we do everything we can to do just that. But I think moving forward, having this as an either annual something in the water bills, as I mentioned, or even having an annual educational night that's put on by the town that residents can come out to, that we can put out to our email list. If you haven't signed up for the Board of Health notifications, I know you'll all be very excited to do so, but going on the town website and signing up for the notifications is a big help to us. I know that, you know, it's tough to get out there, but this is the type of thing you have to just stay on top of, and we're not going to solve the problem one night, we're not going to solve the problem the first year. This is something that you have to look at the plan moving forward of continuing to hit it, continuing to stay on top of it, and to stay after it. Eventually, you're going to get enough folks that know the sources to be aware of it, and we can make them aware of it. In the interim, it's difficult. We're not going to hit everybody. That's the only thing. The water bill is probably our best shot to do it with an informational flyer and a point of, if you do see something, here's where you can go get more information, or here's where you can contact the health aide and the health department to find out more about it. So, you know, that's probably the best shot that we have in the interim. I think annually we have to continue to work forward. I'll let him speak about the robocall.
Communicating with residents is our probably single biggest challenge. It's 27,000 residents. They don't have quite that many different ways to communicate, but it's close. Social media is the fastest and probably most effective single way, but it leaves a lot of people out. So last weekend, I guess starting Thursday night, we had the gas incidents to our north. We had a water issue with Stoner. And the fastest way we could get information out to the town was through social media. And the police social media is the most watched and followed, so that's what we chose to do. Within half an hour, I was amazed that 400 people liked something. I don't know how many other people read it and didn't bother commenting, but that's fast and that's a lot of people. We have other ways to communicate with newsletters. That's a little slower, but it's okay. Someone in Gene's office has thousands of households in Reading signed up. I wanted to say 4,000, but there's only 9,000 households, but I think that's about right, 4,000 emails. So we can't use any one way and think the problem is of communication has been solved. We have to use all these ways. There's at least two members right now of the press media in attendance. I'm sure they'll cover this with stories. One of the challenges with a three-member Board of Health is they're not supposed to talk to each other between meetings. At the last meeting or a recent meeting, they designated Kevin to do communication, so a bunch of us met with just Kevin. And Kevin has put out press releases on behalf of the board because they allowed him to do that. How well circulated they are, how well picked up they are, I don't know yet. In terms of calling people, again, if we had much better facts and had a neighborhood, I'd be willing to do that. I'm not willing to call 9,000 households and tell them this. That's going to cause more harm than it's caused help. We're still in the investigation phase. We don't really even know what to tell them. Please, if you see a rat, let us know. That's not really the kind of message 7,000 of those households are going to want to get based on our past experience. Our biggest single complaint about that system is burnout. Please stop calling me. I don't want to know. I don't want to hear it. So we're really sensitive. The case of, for instance, we had natural gas pipelines starting to explode in Reading. We can't have people not available for that message. So there is no easy way. We have to use lots of channels. We rely on the print media here. We rely on social media. And I know we did a study in the past on the override, and the most single effective way of communication information from the override was from neighbors, which is why we're asking for your help. Not just your behavior, but that you also spread.
Yes.
I just find it kind of ironic that we're saying that social media is like the best way to get this out there, but we're not counting the reports that are on the social media page where people are writing about specific rat sightings.
That's because we have no idea what social media pages other people use. We know what we have, and that's what we're talking about.
Right.
I know, I'm not on any of them. I refuse. My wife, who might have the same last name, but there's another family in town with the last name, so be careful. She belongs to the Reading Parents page, and that's, I know, one of the more popular
right.
ones. I don't know the other ones.
Well, no, the Reading Parents Network alone, there were, and I just find, because we're not counting those, right? We're saying we have 38
well,
things, but if you look at their map, right?
Yes.
There's 400 comments, there's 100 and something pins. So I think with that, we were saying.
Those aren't facts. I've talked to one of my neighbors who sort of started that whole thing. It's for entertainment as much as information. We need facts. If people have reported sightings, they need to tell us.
Right.
We can't chase down. I mean, I'll tell you the absurdity that this country has gone to. A woman in the southwest part of the country a few weeks ago, instead of dialing 911, put on Facebook that her child was choking to death, and that child choked. What is wrong with this?
Yeah,
picture?
I know. I understand the intricacies of social
need to
media.
Tell us.
I'm a communications manager for a lot of it, right? So I get it. I'm just saying,
so
with that map, looking at where the clusters are, I feel like we could possibly pinpoint something and send out a targeted mailing. Everyone has a postal address. If I feel like we got some kind of pamphlet in the mail sooner rather than later, and maybe just hit that targeted area, then at least more people would be aware. Because I've made my neighbors aware that they had nothing, they're not on social media, and they didn't know it prior to that. But where we do have this, I mean, social media could be wrong, and maybe it's for one of my neighbors' entertainments, but in my case, I marked it on the map, and there was a giant rat in my backyard during the day. And my neighbor then found many rats in her yard. So it's obviously, I think, pinpointing that area, we could target that, and that would be a clear move forward to eradicating this issue.
And the meeting tonight and the meeting last week, not led by the Board of Health, was to determine what the Board of Health wants to do for communication. So I'm open to all those ideas, absolutely.
Right.
But I'm telling you, the way we can get the information out about how you need to tell us about this problem is using our social.
Right.
What the board wants to do to communicate, again, we're open-minded other than I've told Chair John Costigan, I don't think a robocall to 9,000 homes is going to be very beneficial.
No, and I don't disagree. I don't think a robocall is the right method, but I think a targeted mailing on top of the social media page and maybe a direct point at that is probably the right way to go because you're going to hit the larger stance of the population.
Yeah, I don't disagree.
Yeah, I think maybe 2 years ago when there was a slight outbreak, we did ask a targeted mail.
Yeah.
When I first came to the Board of Health.
Oh, I saw that because I live behind West Cross and that's where the street is.
So, yes, that is something we will consider.
Right. I just think that everyone gets the mail. Everyone has a postal address. Not everyone's on the Reading Parents Network.
Well, I think a great idea, I mean, take her idea and run with it. We have this packet that we wanted to put out and make our own anyways. This would be a great opportunity to do a targeted mailing just to set up this packet.
Right.
Your information is going to change. You can talk. It's much easier to direct people to this location.
Are you going to get everybody directed to the place? Are you saying send something out to them?
Say,
direct them to
here. We have some information.
Okay.
I don't know. So, this is what people
take a 30 seconds. There's a pause.
Yeah.
I'm just concerned that you send
your
phone and then you're going to
say,
okay. Interesting. So the two line of thought here is that maybe you send something out still to all the households, but not the actual information, because we may want to change and modify where the information is available for them to go see.
Yeah.
Yeah, that actually sounds like a good question.
There's been some evidence of rats in your neighborhood, Palm Road.
Yeah, I...
Please go here. So how would you get that?
Through mail.
We've mailed out.
Yeah, we've mailed the information about where they could find something, this packet, rather than sending the packet. Because then we can, if we need to modify the information, we can do so, and they would have wrong information sitting in their house. I guess that's the...
What percentage of people are on the internet? Any idea?
Yeah, I mean, if we need some sort of... Happy medium that has that, that can have the details shut, but then, you know, just a brief, like, these are quick tips. And it doesn't have to be the whole pamphlet, but it, you know, cover your trash, you know.
Yes.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Just as an aside here, some of you might have noticed it. Dan and I meet particularly or have been rather quiet, uncharacteristically quiet at this meeting. Just so you understand, Dan and I are the liaisons to the Board of Health, and our role is mostly a listening role and reporting back to the board, and at times giving guidance from the select board. But we're not really supposed to be part of this meeting and entering the discussion. I have lots of opinions, but I'm not sharing today because it's not our meeting. So I just want to all of you understand. It's not that we don't care, it's just that we're liaisons.
Were there any other questions?
Yes.
Larry Muse, Washington Street. I grew up at 90 Washington Street, right behind the buildings that got demolished. I've reached out to a couple of the owners of that building. There has been rats in that building as long as I can go back. From the 1980s, the owner had started putting bait traps there. When the current owner sold it, which was back last April, there had been no pest control there for over a year until the demolition permits got signed. Definitely think that's probably where they came from. How they're traveling, don't know. What we need to do is to talk about the dumpsters. No dumpster is rat safe. Any rat can get in any dumpster at any point. Every dumpster has a 2-inch hole right on the bottom to let rainwater out. And for if there's a fire, the fire department doesn't turn it into a swimming pool. Is there any way that we can do pest control for dumpsters in town? If there's a dumpster in town, maybe that business should have pest control, bait boxes. The owner of the old Lincoln Street, he owns other buildings in that area, apartment buildings, and he baits. And every 3 months, the bait boxes are empty and get refilled. I have a friend on Green Street also. He has bait boxes and they get empty. Me personally, I have never seen a rat in Revan in 18 years since when I was a kid. I worked at Atlantic. And Atlantic had a huge rat problem in the basement. You could go down there at any point and move boxes around and rats would run around. And when that building was taken down, there was also an uptick in rats. So the last thing I wanted to say was we talked about Washington Park, the barrels getting emptied sooner. right at the train station, there's about 10 barrels that are not rodent-proof. And they don't get empty. Every single one of them are full. So maybe that's something else we need to look at. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Dumpsters don't have a screen on the hole, 2-inch hole. That's something maybe we could also look into because yes, any other question? Yes.
Yes. My name is Jack Collins. I live in Toronto on County Road. Kristen is one of my neighbors, and Kristen and I passed out a flyer to 260 neighbors, I would say, and that's how we got such a large response at the neighborhood meeting we had last week. There's people here, I think, that heard about the problem from the flyer that we didn't even know that there was rats in our neighborhood and now are more aware. So I think that there's definitely a need for some sort of communication targeted to the area that we live in. I personally had no idea that I had rats on my property until I heard about it from a neighbor, and I think all of you guys have heard and have been quoted in papers saying that we caught 10 rats in my yard in 6 days. So I think that there's a lot of people that still are not aware, and a targeted mailing will certainly help. I think, the response that we got that quick proved that it was necessary for that area. That's the first thing. The second thing I wanted to ask is, John, at the beginning you were speaking when you were reading some of the laws, I guess. You talked about watertight trash receptacles. I don't know exactly the verbiage. But can you speak to a little bit more of what that means? Because this morning when I was driving my son to school, I drove down Westcroft, which is a pretty long street. Today was trash day for them. And there was a decent amount of trash out that was not in trash barrels. So are you not supposed to put trash out that's not in a trash barrel? Or is a trash bag considered watertight?
Town does not require trash barrels. A trash bag is fine, and that often is a problem for this issue. Whether we should change the rules or not is an open question, but two trash barrels or the equivalent in bags is okay. If someone has more trash than that out, they have probably, hopefully, called JRM and arranged for a pickup. If not, again, like Joanne's problem, they're not going to get a pickup.
So can there be consideration the trash needs to be in a barrel?
Yep. Yes, absolutely. We have a 10-year contract with JRM. We have to amend it, and we have to communicate that one well throughout the town. And again, it's a good idea, but I'm just remembering what JRM told me, which he doesn't believe the trash or the recycling source. It doesn't mean it shouldn't be fixed. It doesn't mean if it's a little problem it shouldn't be fixed. But just to keep that in mind.
I mean, I definitely agree. Like, I see what you're saying about that, but if I think about my specific property and where the rats were on my property, all of those typical food sources for them are not there. There's no standing water anywhere on my property, on any of my abutting neighbor's property. Our trash is kept in my garage with covers. My recycle, I have a brand new recycle bin with a cover, as I noticed that many of my neighbors do, as I drove yesterday morning on trash day. Home Depot and Lowe's probably sold a lot of recycle bins with covers since this started. But we don't have, there's no food source right in my surrounding neighbors. So I have to believe that trash is part of their food source. I don't know what else the food source could be unless they're going to mobile and coming back, which from what I have researched and read is that they usually don't go more than 100 feet to get their food and come back. So I have to believe that it's trash. Maybe not recycled, but that it could be trash somewhere that they're getting it from. I can't think of what another food source would be.
I live at 22 Colonial Drive, and up until a couple of years ago, I held a commercial certification in pesticide and pest control for the state of Massachusetts. And I actually worked in the big dig in rodent control. back when that was being built. So as far as rodent control and things like, people have got up and talked about the building that was being torn down. When they were building the big dig, every site in that before they could take one shovel full of dirt out of the ground had to be rodent free for 3 months. And they had cameras on every one of those sites. If they got to 89 days and a rodent showed up in one of the sites, the clock started again for 3 months. So a lot of times, contractors, trust me, they don't want buildings when they're tearing them down to be causing problems with people that are going to be their new neighbors. That said, there's a lot of talk that people are saying about dumpsters and trash and things like that. Recycle, trash, that's not where these rodents are feeding. You have to remember what is happening right now. Everything is coming into bloom. Everything's coming right. Anyone that lives in a house, that anyone has a little garden, that they grow tomatoes, squash, anything like that in the garden, that's food for rats. The favorite food source for any rodent is nuts and seeds, okay? Every grass and every legume that is growing in anyone's yard right now is coming to seed. That's all food for rodents. Anyone that has a bird feeder, that's a tremendous food source for rodents. So a rat is not going to go. One person said rats don't usually go any more than 100 feet. Maximum they usually go is 300 feet from any food source. And they don't have to go very far, and they don't want to go very far. They're very afraid of going out of their harborage area. So if they have a bird feeder, they're fat, dumb, and happy. They come out of their hole, they come out at night, they feed it everyone's bird feeder, they clean up all that little stuff that's underneath the bird feeder that the birds and the squirrels kick out. They love it. So instead of looking at, you know, the Dunkin' Donuts or the restaurant that's close and the dumpster that's there, look to the bird feeder that might be in 6 out of 8 houses that are in the neighborhood. That's where the rodents are feeding. So, and the biggest thing that was said tonight about how you actually get a handle on this is everyone working together. Everyone has to do their part. And one of the things that I had spoke to Mr. Costigan about before the meeting is, just because you have rodents in your yard, that does not mean that you're dirty. Rats actually like to be very clean. They preen themselves just like a cat does all the time. So if you have rats in your house, that doesn't mean that you're dirty. That doesn't mean that you have things that are unkempt. That just means that you have a place where there's a food source that's nearby, and there's a place for them to live nearby. The first order of any rodent control problem, that rodent control project, is effective inspection. Know where they are, where they're living, and where they're coming out of. The second control measure is exclusion. That means you build them out from wherever they're living. You fill in their burrows, you close up their little holes. And by the way, a rat can get in and out of a hole that's no bigger than $0.50. So the holes can be pretty small that they can come in and out of. Thirdly, after you do the inspection and then the exclusion, is you take away, and when you exclude them, you take away the harborage area. And the third thing you do is you take away their food source. And then there's other control measures that use pesticide and traps. Traps tend to be very, very effective when you exclude them out from where the harborage area is and take their food away. But once you understand the biology and the habits of rats, they're actually very easy to control, only if there's a consistent control and plan put in place and measures taken to try and control. Notice that someone, I didn't say eradication, because that's a very, very difficult process to actually accomplish. But control you can get. And control you can get by everyone working together and working in a cohesive manner and understanding what the problem is and how to address it and how to control it.
Thank you, Dave. We have a question from Bob. Could you answer for us?
Thanks. Thanks, Dave. Can you comment on how water source plays a role in standing water? Is there any magic about that?
No. Basically, mice and rats don't need any water at all.
Yes.
Back to James 31 Graham Road, just to follow up on food sources. A lot of people in my area have compost bins in the back. In fact, we just got one last year. Is that something we need to take away? And a lot of people in my area use it for gardening, of course. And we're not super gardeners, so we won't kill me if we have to get rid of it, but I don't know if it's something we should think about getting rid of next door. They did see a rat, and I'm going to talk to him because I don't think he reported it, and I'm getting to report it. It was sad. So, but like I said, there's a lot of us with compost bins.
I think Emmy addressed that a little earlier, but
I did actually answer that.
Okay.
There are compost bins, those big rotary ones that you can use. Those are sealed.
The other thing is that you have a compost bin that has plywood sides, that you have earth up against the plywood sides, then just cover it with hardware cloth.
Plastic.
Yeah, the plastic one, the rodents can't get in.
Oh, they can't?
No.
Oh.
No, because that's enclosed.
Just put something
they
in.
They can't go under it, though?
Under the, what?
The bottom of the compost bin.
He can, but as soon as they start digging a hole, then you know that they're there, and then you take in the second measure to correct it.
Okay.
But the things you put in the compost bin, you're ringing the dinner bell.
I know, that's what had me
you know, watermelon seeds, you know, seeds that come out of cucumbers, zucchini squash, summer squash. That's what they eat.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Would you recommend it this time of year when there are oak trees create acorns, chestnuts? Would you
acorns, chestnuts, beech nuts, butternuts? They're all nuts. They eat those.
Would you recommend like scouring your yard for nuts?
Just think of how little that animal is and how much, you know, they can eat one acorn, would feed them for a week. So, you know, it's, you know, you have to be very, very diligent as to how you remove all of the food sources. And yes, that would be one way that you could do that, is pick up all the acorns and that, because then they'd be in the liquid something else. But don't forget, as soon as you take the food source away from your house, guess where they're gonna go? They're gonna look at for it somewhere else. So.
Spoken about possibly exterminating Washington Park, which is great. However, I live on Pineville Ave. A block from Washington Park is Pineville Woods. We've discussed how they burrow under the leaves and all of, you know, forage around looking for food and so forth. But if they hit Washington on Pineville Woods, it's going to open them up to all new neighborhoods. So I'm interested in knowing how you plan on exterminating Washington Park.
Well, we would consult with a professional pest control company. I'm not sure if they discussed anything with us.
No.
So I don't have an answer for that right now. That is something we would look into.
When
we would have to let anyone know. We'd give them at least about 48 hours of notice. Yes.
Just to set a couple things that were said. I was talking to a neighbor just the other night, and who's on, I think it's Howard Street, and they had seen the flyer on the road issue. But because there was nothing from the town, they didn't, you know, think it was, you know, that it was just a local problem or a local reaction or something. So some letter formally from the town in the neighborhood would be useful.
Howard has called.
Yes.
But probably not the neighbor I talked to, who
first start, especially targeting the neighborhoods that we know we're getting the most reports out of to begin with, as we work on. I think this is a great guide that we put up on the website, so I would want to continue to work on this guideline that we, I mean, steal from Cambridge and like that, and just make sure, again, better make sure that it's incorporated as a kind of something that's more ready as well, as part of, as well, of getting this on, not necessarily an immediate next step, but soon thereafter, would be my thinking. And then I still think, from a long-term standpoint, we do need to stay on and have some kind of annual, whether it's a mailing or an event where we invite the public out to hear about best practices, prevention, controlling, adaptation practices. I think that's something we should definitely have.
Yes, I agree with that, absolutely. Now, the mailing, we would mail to the specific area with the an information of where to find this, or is this like a mailing with the actual information?
We should probably put something on there that's a, you know, maybe one page, two at the most, in front back, kind of, I guess, a synopsis. This is a probably about a 12-page packet that people can look through at leisure, but usually anything you're going to send them in the mail is going to be discarded quickly if it can't be, you know, a quick bullet point. So I think you send them what you call a drip mail, right? So here are some points that you may want to pay attention to, and if you want further detail, here's where you can go to find further detail. And that way you're covering both those folks that really want to dig into it and get every little ounce of detail, and folks that just give you the cliff notes so I can know what to do with my house, type of thing. So it should be information, I guess, but in regards to what Dave was talking about, you know, food sources and outreach, I guess we'll focus on it. Yes, that's quick.
Well, that was my question, is what date should we set to do this? Yeah, that will be our goal for the next week, to get out the flyer, an informational flyer with additional information that is obtained online.
Yeah. So when you send that out, are you going to specifically say, if you send it to a targeted area, that you're sending it to that targeted area because there has been rat activity?
There has been reports of sightings.
Yeah, I think that only adds to it, right? Because as Dave was saying, and I think what you've come to the conclusion as well is that this is not a me problem, this is a mess problem. And specifically right now, it's your the area that you're living in. So I think people, you put that right at the top, hey, you're getting this for this reason.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea.
Actually, I gave something to Matt at our last meeting, and something to that effect. So I don't know if he's looked at it, maybe going to sort of edit what I had to say. I did turn that into Matt.
Okay. So here comes the tricky part. If we don't come up with the language tonight, and we want to get this out.
You've got to first.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
It's you.
Okay. If the other board members had ideas that ran through Laura?
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just don't want to.
Just don't copy each other.
Well, I just don't want it to be the end all tonight for, you know, you wake up in the morning and go, oh, we should absolutely. Okay.
And then she can
kind of compile it.
Yes. And at your next meeting, you can see it. But hopefully by then.
But we're going to have to send it out. And that's where the comfort level of the board's going to be, because we're going to have to send it out prior to whatever. See the entire year.
Was our next meeting still when it was originally?
Well, we can meet next week. Wasn't it next week?
Is it
the
next one next week anyway?
I want to say it.
Today.
Well, it's going to be next
Wednesday,
which we scheduled for today.
Changed back to September 18th. The original posted schedule was September 18th.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm Big Shields from Rainbow World.
Yes.
The people here are the perfect ones to ask. What's it cost to send a mail now? $3,500 for the postage alone? And then you have your clerical costs and the paper and the envelopes.
Yep.
So is that $7,000?
Not for a target, but not enough for me.
No, not for that.
Townwide, it's a climb up there, absolutely.
We've got probably 7,000 residents.
And I think we're discussing doing a targeted mailing on neighborhoods that have been indicated, but otherwise you'd be right.
Got the money?
If we had done the last water bill, yes, I don't think we want to wait.
Yeah,
see
no,
what
I'm
other
saying
is going on. Maybe we can piggyback, but if not, the simple one page.
That's why I said, you know, we should definitely need to vet. I think it's a nice pamphlet that's up there.
that's the basis we want to make for the flyer, and then put it up. You can always change it at a later date. You can always modify it on the website at a later date, but just from just to get it up in that neighborhood at the time. Yeah. You know, I think that might be a good if you're comfortable.
No, that's sort of what we designated you to do,
okay.
So I'm comfortable with that.
That's what I can run with if you are comfortable with
that. Is that fine with you?
Well, is there a way that we can that before it's like finalized, it can just more to us?
Only tonight. Tonight or the next meeting? We could convene the three of us just to say, we have agenda writers to look over this flyer and send it out. We could always do that too.
Yeah, great.
All right. I'll get it together as fast as I can. So we'll have to, geez, I really don't know what to do.
Yep.
We'll have to come up with a quick meeting here to get as much time as we can. My guess is we wouldn't need more than a half an hour. Sooner the better, but it's tough for our own schedules.
Yeah.
Got it. Writing me down.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was again. noticed that